So here with AJ Wood for the Footie Show. AJ, and we're going to be chatting for the about the transfer market the first half. So can you just tell us where we're at? I'm getting all these press releases, you know, players coming in, players going out, mostly loan moves. We've loaned a lot of players out, I know that much. Just where are we at now that transfer deadline's passed?
Well, yeah. I think we've spoken about this so many times, this window, this summer, this year. And within the last, since the time we've been in the Premier League, really, probably the last two or three seasons, the club keep talking about being this top 10 side and being this side that's going to push for top 10. After the window we've just had, we're going further and further away from teams, not even top 10 teams anymore. We're going further and further away from everyone in terms of quality of signings, in terms of how we're acting in the window. This season, for me and for everyone, was the perfect opportunity after selling Ben White for 50 million. Yeah, it's probably 25, 30 million up front, but you know it's guaranteed 50 million. To sign a goal scorer within our budget, we've had all summer to do that. We haven't. Well, we've signed a goal scorer and sent him out alone to Stoke. So, yeah, we'll go on to how... Our loan dealings and our policies, but yeah, it's for me a disappointing window. Mark Cucurella looks like a good player.
He does, yeah.
And him and Mwepu, we've signed six this summer, seven if you count Sarmiento. But yeah, it's not looking too promising. We're only going to see two of them this season at a push, probably. Sherpin's going to be our backup. Simmer's gone out on loan. Mitoma's gone out on loan. Sarmiento's for the 23s. So you're going to see Mwepu and Cucurella. And Mwepu, obviously, is going to struggle for game time from the start because of Bissouma, Lallana, who are attacking midfielders. They've obviously got to take some time to get to the Premier League, kind of the speed of the Premier League. But, yeah, very disappointing. We've managed to do well on outgoings in terms of clearing out big wages like Izquierdo, Johan Bash, Ben White's obviously gone for a big fee. We've done well in that aspect, but I think everyone was just hoping and kind of waiting for that striker to come in. And everyone knows until Brighton sign that striker, they're not progressing. I don't care if they sign, they could sign the world's best. They could sign Sergio Ramos at centre half, and they still wouldn't improve because they need to score goals. And without scoring goals, they're not going to get anywhere further. Which leaves us on the topic of where our goal scoring opportunities are this season. We've got three. We've got three strikers. We've got Neil Mopay, who's hopefully he's got two from three this season. Hopefully, he's coming good. But we can't rely on just him. Like if he gets injured or if he has a barren spell, then we've got to have other options. We've got Aaron Connolly, which we've spoken about on the show so many times during this window. It's so clear to see he needs confidence and needs to play in the Championship alone. We've talked about all these 19 loans we've had. He's the one that probably out of all 19, I'd have said, needs a loan more than any of them.
Yeah.
Confidence-wise, he looks shot. Let's be honest, he's a player who's come from the youth systems, from the 23s. With no competitive, no first team, no senior football experience, and has been thrown straight into the Premier League. It's a very tough ask on him. I know he hasn't been the model professional in the last couple of years, but I think a young kid being thrown into it is tough on him. And I really do think a season on the Championship, scoring 20, 30 goals, or even if he scores 15 goals, that makes such a difference to a player confidence-wise. He can come back into that first team and really push on. Not to be, he's going to be bit part player for Brighton again this season. He's just, unfortunately for me, he's just not good enough at this point. His confidence isn't there. We saw against Watford, he missed from about a yard. We won 2-0, but for him to score a goal would be so good for him. He missed, I remember at West Brom last year, I was at the Hawthorns, he missed from about a yard as well. He's a finisher, but who can't finish at the moment because he's got no confidence. And then we've obviously got Danny Welbeck after that. But we know, unfortunately, it's if not when. It's when, not if, Danny Welbeck gets injured. Unfortunately, we know, touch wood, hopefully he can stay fit for a period of time. But we know he's been here for a year now and probably missed 10, 15 games so far. He's obviously missed the opening 2.5. He was on the bench at the weekend. But
yeah, he was on a bench for Everton, yeah.
Big risk from Brighton to allow all these attacking players, Tal, Yambash, to leave and not bring in any replacements. You've obviously got... You can play Trossard up front, but he's not a striker. Can you imagine Trossard against Harry Maguire and Raphael Varane? Or even like Tarkowski and me, it'd be absolutely bullied all day as a lone striker against them. It's just not going to work. Very, very frustrating. I can understand why they've sent Simmer out on loan. I'd rather them not sign Simmer at all and buy it and use the money to spend on an actual striker that they can use.
How much do we pay for Simmer? Because Simmer can always go. I mean, we've got four strikers really, because we can just recall him on the Stoke loan, can't we? Can't we do that? Isn't
that? No, there's a rule that he can't play for three clubs in the same season. So technically, no, he can't play for us this season.
Oh, right. Okay. So that's that one gone then. So, I mean, we're really relying on, I mean, it's incredible, isn't it? Situation to be in. Crazy. I mean, what happens if all three are injured then? Trossard will have to play up front or something. I mean, is that, I guess that's what they're thinking, right?
I'm sure Dan Byrne can play as a target, man.
Yeah.
No, it's not ideal. It's really not ideal. Yeah. You see the way they're going with the selling of players, getting rid of big wages, players on big wages. You think they were looking at really making that big mega signing, and
yeah, well, I was looking forward to it, and I still thought it was going to come through it. Like, I was watching it on Sky News, you know, 5 to 11. I was still thinking something was going to come through out of nowhere, but in the end, it never happened.
Nothing in the pipeline. Yeah. But you look at it now, like, we've got rid of White proper, Izquierdo, Matt Ryan, Victor Gyökeres, Yam Malaka, Yambash. Loads of players that are on big wages, and there's about 20 loans in it. There's Teddy Jenks gone to Aberdeen, Alex Cochran gone to Hearts, Ben Carl Rushworth, Florin Andone, Paul Van Heck, Andy Zakiri, Christian Walton, Moises Caicedo, Lars Dendonka.
Dendonka's gone there.
Mental. I don't understand it.
Cassiano. I mean, we've never seen these players.
But Caicedo, right, for me, is going to learn more sitting on the bench at the Amex, training with the players we have currently, than playing for a team I've never heard of in Belgium. Not being rude to the team, he's not going to come back and be like this unbelievable player after a season in Belgium. We look at the players we've signed from Belgium. Apart from Trossard, there's no one. They've obviously, since Dan Ashworth has come in and since they've restructured the transfer board, you can see that their policy is clear. They're going to sign young players. They're going to loan them out. They're going to pretty much like Chelsea do. But Chelsea actually, unfortunately, have a side that can compete properly in the Premier League. Whereas Brighton aren't that side yet. They need to make signings for now, not for 10 years' time, because there is a real worry that there is going to be a season where they keep buying all these young players, spending all their transfer money on the young players for 10 years down the line and find themselves in the Championship because they don't have the players for now. Everyone knows they struggle for goals and they just haven't filled it. I don't understand. They're obviously... To the press, to the public, to the fans, they're always like, "Yeah, we're happy with how we are, what we've got." Then they need to stop thinking about this being this top 10 side, because if they're happy with where they are, which is 17th, 16th, 15th, then fine. But they need to stop telling the fans that they want to be this top 10 club, because they're never going to be that top 10 club unless they improve in certain areas. For now, not for 10 years' time.
Yeah.
Because it's just not going to work. They're going to find themselves in a relegation battle again this season, in my opinion now. Cucurella's a great buy, don't get me wrong, but he's not going to sort out the top of the pitch. We still haven't got a right back. I know Veltman can play there, but Lamptey's going to be probably injured again sometime soon. Unfortunately, his hamstrings don't look to be in best nick.
Is he going to get back in the side? And
well, they don't really tell you, basically, Brighton. They tell you he's back in training, then they tell you he's not back in training. It's just a bit of a merry-go-round. But Lamptey's hamstrings have been obviously affecting him for over a year now. It's a shame because he's a great player, but I don't know what's going on with him. Someone needs to really help him and sort him out, because for a youngster like that to be out with hamstring injuries for that long is not normal.
All right, cool. We'll leave it for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be with AJ Wood discussing the Everton game and also Brighton going forward. Back here with AJ Wood, sports journalist, for the second half of the vote. AJ, reviewing Everton then we can preview the Brentford game and the I know Leicester and Arsenal coming up as well, and Palace. Everton, 2-0 defeat. We played all right, I think, the first 20 minutes, half an hour. You might have a different opinion, but we were not going to ball about, not creating any chances. We didn't have a shot on goal in that first half, AJ.
Well, yeah, it's the same. I put on Twitter at half time, it literally reminded me of last season. We play this nice football, we keep the ball on the floor, yeah, exactly, we keep the ball, right. We look like Barcelona, pass it around. As soon as we get in the final third, there's nothing, absolutely nothing.
Yeah,
right. Everton literally could have sat down and had a cup of coffee. There was no threat whatsoever to their goal. As Pickford didn't make a save in that first half. Everton, fair play to them. They looked impressive. They looked a good side. But we didn't cause them any problems at home, which is a worrying thing. They were without Yerry Mina at centre-half. We know they're defensively a little bit frail. They've got Seamus Coleman, who's on the older side now. We didn't cause him any threat. Our wing-backs were central midfielders with very little pace. Unfortunately, if you're going to play wing-backs, you can't play wing-backs that run slower than our centre-halves. And unfortunately, that's what happened. And Damari Gray literally had Pascal Gross on toast all game. And you saw from the goal he scored, it was a great goal, but he literally just jogged past him and put it in the bottom corner. It's too easy at Premier League level. And yeah, but they were too good. It goes down to Brighton. We create enough, but we don't score enough. And that's unfortunately going to be the recurring theme on these shows until we sign someone.
Yeah. I mean, Everton, they've just signed Rondon, haven't they, as well? So they're not lacking anything up front. They've got Calvin Lewin. They've got Gray, obviously, there.
But that just shows, Mark. That just shows where Brighton are in this situation.
Well,
like, Everton already have Calvert-Lewin and Richarlison that can play at striker. They've just signed Salomon Rondon as a third player. They're not in Europe. They're technically our rivals. They finished a little bit higher than us last year. But if we want to be in that top 10, then we've got to be competing with them.
Yeah.
We're not going to be competing with that top front three. You look at Wolves. Wolves had a poor season last year. They had Raul Jimenez out for a lot of the year. But you look at Raul Jimenez, and he's quality. They've obviously got Fabio Silva, who's an 18-year-old from Portugal. He's, again, young, learning the game. And they've just signed Hwang Hee-chan from Leipzig with Champions League experience. Like, we're just not going to compete with these teams. So we should stop talking about, if we're not going to compete financially or transfer market-wise with these teams, we can stop thinking about this top 10 stuff. I don't understand. If they're going to say we're going to be top 10 in 3 years, you have to start competing with these teams. Like, you just, it's impossible not to. I know they've got more money than us, but we've just got 50 million in the door, plus a lot of wages that we've managed to recoup from players. And yeah, we're not going to compete with these Everton's Wolves. Even look at Southampton. Danny Ings went, they replaced him with two. Adam Armstrong, who started the season well, and Armando Broja from Chelsea on loan. It's just, I know it's not like world-class signings, but it's bodies, isn't it?
Yeah. So these away games, to me, I know it's only three games in, but Brentford away, Palace away, Norwich are quite key, I would say, because obviously we've got Leicester and Arsenal at home, AJ. I'm not. I know we've got 6 points from three games. Brilliant start to the season, even if we lost to Everton. Brilliant. We only won 9 last season. We got 2 wins under our belt. But I'm just saying that these games are quite crucial. We've got to probably win one of those, haven't we, really?
Yeah, we can't get too carried away. With all due respect, we've played Burnley and Watford. Let's not beat around the bush here. Like, yeah, they're 2 difficult games. Every game in the league is difficult. But we've played 2 of the lesser sides. We haven't played anyone. Well, we've got absolutely battered by Everton. So that should be a worry in itself.
Yeah.
But, yeah, you're right. Brentford away is going to be a very, very tough game. But we have to try and win that game. Norwich as well. Early on in the season, Norwich are favourites to go down again. So we need to start winning these games. Palace, I don't know what's going to happen in that game. I'm actually scared for that Palace game, to be honest.
Yeah.
With Edouard there now. I think it could be a difficult one. I just don't see where we're going to score goals. Leicester at home, we know Leicester, a weird one. We always look good in the first half against Leicester, and then the second half we always tend to turn up and they score for about 3 or 4. So that'll be a fun one. And Arsenal, you don't know what's going to happen. Honestly, they could beat us 6-0 and we could beat them 6-0. So I really don't know what's going to happen in that one.
Yeah.
It'd be good Amazon doc if we beat him 6-0, though. But
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
honestly, they could have a new manager by the time we play them. They honestly could.
Yeah, so it's going to be an interesting next few games then. Just going back to Everton, I mean, they had a lot of, you know, they looked like they had goals in them, didn't they, Everton, as well? Pickford pulled off a good save as well, has to be said. Going forward to, I mean, Palace, they've had an interesting season. They had, 7 players brought in and 11 went out. They've basically got a brand new first team almost, haven't they? 3/4 of the first team on the pitch there. Gallagher scoring over the weekend. I mean, I thought Palace would struggle, but now they've made all these signings, it makes me wonder, maybe they'll be mid-table again.
They've changed completely the way they play. I think it takes a little bit of time to realise what they're doing. Yeah. Playing the more attacking way. With 2 solid centre halves, Guehi and Anderson. They've obviously got a lot of attacking talent. Zaha, Eze, but he's injured at the moment, but he'll be back. Obviously, Edouard is the focal point now. They're dangerous. They really are dangerous. Yeah. I think Patrick Vieira will do a fine job there. You've obviously got Conor Gallagher in there as well. He scored 2 last weekend against West Ham.
Second goal was brilliant. Yeah.
Yeah, great turn. A player we just don't have. We don't have that in our team, creativity like that. A midfielder that can pop up and score goals. Palace are going to be a decent side. Everton, again, you look at Damari Gray. How good was Damari Gray at the weekend, Mark?
Yeah, pretty good. Yeah, decent.
1.5 million they bought him for in the summer.
Yeah.
It's mental. Like, that's great. But that's an absolute steal. He was unbelievable, Damari Gray, at the weekend. Best player on the pitch, in my opinion. And, yeah. You look at how they play, he was superb.
Yeah. Should we just park up Brighton in an international break? We've got the World Cup qualifiers coming up, haven't we, as well now? So how do you think that's going to play out? England in a fairly easy group, aren't they? So any thoughts on the international break? We need that as well, Brighton, don't we, to get some of these players back up to full fitness. So
that's my music. That's music to my ears, Mark. Park up Brighton. I'd love to.
Yeah.
I'd love to park near the ground as well, but can't do that. Internationals, England, obviously, the first internationals break since the Euro heartache, shall we say, against Italy. They should obviously walk this World Cup qualifying group. Hungary, they've got in the first game, should be straightforward. That's the toughest one of the group. They've obviously got Andorra and Lithuania and all sorts like that. We know what to expect. We should walk these games. Hopefully, the team start playing well and they can really look forward. It's a bit disappointing. No Mason Greenwood. I think he's probably England's best wide player at the moment. But he wasn't selected.
Yeah.
But yeah, it should be good. Should be interesting.
Yeah. Ronaldo, what kind of impact is he going to have then coming back to the Premier League? I mean, obviously he's got 100 million Instagram followers. It's a shame he just couldn't get Messi in at City. And it would have, to have these two players in the Premier League would have been brilliant. We got one of them in. We've also got Saul from Atletico Madrid, who's a decent player. We've got some decent players actually playing in the Premier League, haven't we? Some really good players that are going to make a big difference as well. You know, international players that are going to kind of make it even more, competitive than it already is.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to to facing against these kind of guys.
Yeah,
it's going to be great fun watching Brighton trying to defend Ronaldo and stuff like that. But
yeah.
but yeah, it's great, great for the league, great for the sport. I think Ronaldo, no one really knows what to expect from Ronaldo. Everyone's seen him boss it in Madrid, boss it in Manchester before, boss it at Juve a little bit, done okay there. But he's 36 now, so no one really knows what to expect. He can play, obviously. He's a legend of the game. Yeah. But it's just thinking about how he fits into a Premier League now, whether his body can still take it. These games, they come thick and fast. They're high intensity. No one's questioning his legacy, just whether they're questioning what he can do on the pitch these days. And it'll be very interesting to see. I think he's in line to play against Newcastle in the first game, which is just ridiculous. But Man United have really signalled their intent with the signings this summer.
They have. I mean, they're going to have a team there. Well, they're going to have Pogba, Ronaldo. They're going to have
Bruno Fernandes, Cavani, Sancho, Varane.
Yeah.
Yeah, not bad side, is it?
Exactly. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to the Champions League because I think the Chelsea are really going to boss that. Probably only one or two teams that can probably tip them to another title, I would say. Probably Bayern Munich and PSG. What do you think with that?
Well, you look at PSG's group. They got Man City and Leipzig. It's not an easy group.
No.
It would be funny, wouldn't it, if they signed Messi and kept Mbappe and then lost to Leipzig and ended up in the Europa League.
Yeah,
that'd be great fun. But that'd be great. Watching City versus PSG would be a really tasty encounter, I think.
Yeah, looking forward to that. That's it for now, AJ. Let's catch up next week and we'll review all the international games. Take care. Thanks.
Cheers, Mark. Cheers.